I will give you a heads up. We are not going to get through everything. This is so much here. Give you the outline. There's some things I wanted to hang on this morning. And then if you want to prepare ahead for next Sunday, you can start reading chapter 19 of Luke's Gospel. We're going to go there next in preparation for Easter. We'll just keep taking this journey. This morning we're going to read chapter 11, verses 1 through 4. But don't worry, all the songs are appropriate. We will look at the lamp and all that. At least give you context. Luke 11, chapter 1. It happened that while Jesus was praying in a certain place, after he had finished, one of the disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray just as John also taught his disciples." And he said to them, "When you pray, say, 'Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves also forgive everyone who is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation.'" I know that this is somewhat brief, but we are going to walk through chapter 11. But I'm just going to tell you that we're going to hang primarily on the prayer of chapter 11, verses 1 through 4. But I will give you the rest of the context of what is here. This is really, so I planned a totally different sermon for this morning, and I only got halfway through the message last Sunday, so here's the second half. But it is titled "The Kingdoms in Conflict," and it's very appropriate because in chapter 10, we had the arrival of the kingdom. The kingdom is at hand, and now we have this movement into chapter 11 that tells us there is a conflict that is ongoing. That is sort of going to be the backdrop of everything, but I wanted to look at the issue of prayer. And I hope that there are some things that we can glean from this in regards to prayer and what it ought to be like and our perspective on it and that. But I remind you the fact that for Luke, the kingdom of God is an important subject, not only in the gospel, but also in Acts. And I give you several reasons for why it's important in Luke's gospel. We can see very evidently in his writing. First is the frequency of its occurrence. Over 30 times we find it referenced in the gospel. And then he brackets the book of Acts with this theme of the kingdom of God in chapter 1, verse 3 of Acts, and then in chapter 28, verse 31. We have this bracketing the book of Acts, which is very significant because Acts is the story of the beginning of the church, which I think is very poignant for us to understand that when we look at the church, we have to look at it in light of a bigger plan, the plan of God. And when you look at the choosing of the 12, 12 specifically, why? Because they're going to sit on thrones and they're going to rule over the 12 tribes of Israel. This leads into understanding later on as we learn about the church that we also will reign with Christ. So all of this is a part of God's bigger plan, this kingdom plan. And so he brackets Acts with this and it runs all the way through the book, but it's all the way through his gospel. It is a major issue for Luke. Another thing is the occurrence of it at key points in his narrative in the gospel. So just some of the times that we find the occurrence of the kingdom of God reference, the first time is in the birth narratives in chapter 1, verse 33. A very significant point in which we find this in reference to the angel Gabriel speaking to Mary in the birth announcement. We find it as the main subject of Jesus' preaching in chapter 4, verse 43. This is after Luke presents Jesus' thematic purpose statement given in Nazareth, and then following that episode, we have this declaration that I must preach the kingdom of God to other cities also. We find in the Sermon on the Mount in chapter 6, verse 20, the inheritance of the righteous, "For yours not will be the kingdom of God, but yours is the kingdom," present tense. And it's interesting because, you know, my dad was reminding me that there was a period in the church where the Sermon on the Mount was not even preached on in church. Reason being is because they believed that it was principles of the kingdom. Therefore, it was for the future, had nothing to do with us today. It has everything to do with us today. And if I can, this is just my lesson learned from Luke's a presentation of the Sermon on the Mount, or in his case, the Sermon on the Plain. The Sermon on the Mount, if I can sum it up in just this statement, it is this: to be willing to be taken advantage of for the sake of the kingdom. That's it. That's the whole Sermon on the Mount. The turning of the cheek, right? If someone takes your coat, give me a shirt. All of it, if it can be summed up in one thought, it is be willing to be taken advantage of for the sake of the kingdom. And if our eyes are on the kingdom, we'll be willing to go through those things. And we will be willing to be taken advantage of for the sake of God's overall kingdom plan and His work. We have then the message given to the 12. It is to proclaim the kingdom of God. The message to the 70 or 72 to go out and preach the same message, the kingdom of God. So these are very significant points in the life and ministry of Jesus Christ where we see the kingdom of God is present. The disciples' prayer, as we will look at in chapter 11, verse 2, as looking forward to the consummation of the kingdom plan, and we pray with anticipation, the eschatological anticipation for it to be fulfilled. And then in chapter 13, we have the eschatological teaching of Jesus in chapter 13, verses 28 and 29, where he's going to refer to, again, the kingdom of God. And he moves in this perspective, the eschatological perspective, in chapter 12. And I just, you know, I was dwelling on this, but the early church, they believed in the imminent return of Christ. They believed that he was at the door. And chapter 12 bears this out, verse 35. Notice with me, be dressed in readiness, keep your lamps lit. Be like men, verse 36, be like men who are waiting for their master when he returns from the wedding feast, so that they may immediately open the door to him when he comes and knocks. Blessed are those slaves whom the master will find on the alert when he comes. The early church lived this way with the anticipation that he would come and consummate what was begun. There was a period, though, for a long period, where the church started to live in light of the fact that he's not coming just yet. We're swinging back the other way. My encouragement to all of us is to start living life as Christ is coming, right, at any moment. Be ready. Be dressed and ready. I mean, otherwise, the exhortations in chapter 12 mean nothing, right? Have your lamps lit. Be ready. That means nothing if we don't anticipate the imminent return of Christ. So we see the kingdom is all the way through here. It's through Luke's gospel narrative. It is in key passages. It's also seen as betrayal of salvation, as entering into the kingdom. We also find this thought in John's gospel, chapter 3, when Jesus is talking to Nicodemus, right? And he says, unless you are born again, you will not enter the kingdom of God. So we see it presented, even the Gospels, especially Luke, that it's presented as you come to salvation, you are entering into the kingdom of God. So it is a significant theme for the Gospel and for Acts. And it is something that should be significant for us as well. We need to see our lives in light of the kingdom of God and God's kingdom plan. And I'll just tell you, in regards to our prayer life, it should radically shape and mold it then. And we'll see that our theology should impact our prayer. Right? We should pray what we believe. And that is really what Jesus is instructing the disciples in chapter 11. Another is that the subject of Jesus' teaching, when you think about the time of his resurrection to the time of the ascension, over that period of time, what did he teach on? Acts chapter 1, verse 3. He taught about the kingdom of God. Significant then, right? It's important for the disciples to know this truth. And then they ask him, well, is it now that you're going to restore the kingdom to Israel? And he says, it's not for you to know the times and seasons. To use the MacArthur's words, it's none of your business. When it comes, just be ready. Just be ready, right? And so we need to live in anticipation of the consummation of God's kingdom. In the in-between time, we are in conflict. We'll see this in chapter 11. The chapter 19 also, we'll see some other things we're supposed to do as we anticipate the consummation of the coming of the kingdom of God. The kingdom presence is seen in Luke's gospel, primarily in Jesus' ministry in several ways. The prophecies are fulfilled. Jesus bears this out as he reads from Isaiah. But he stops short of talking about the wrath of God. Now is the favorable year of the Lord. Now is the time for mercy and grace and salvation. But there is a time for the outpouring of God's wrath that will come. But Luke highlights this through his gospel, also through the fact that the oppressed are delivered from demons. We see this in chapter 10 and chapter 11, but this goes back. These go back to Jesus' purpose statement in Luke chapter 4 as he reads from Isaiah, all of these elements. And so the In Judaism, they believed that there was the present age and then the age to come. The age to come was the Messianic age. And they believed all of these elements were a part of the Messianic age. There was going to be a restoration of creation, all of these things. And so what happens is with Luke, we see this merging of the two together. It's already broken in on the present age. And what we see then is we see just glimmers of what's going to come in ultimate fulfillment. So we realize there's a period of anticipation of the consummation, what's going to come. There's things that we have to do now, but we look forward to what is to come. So it's like the Mount of Transfiguration. We got a glimmer, and then we go down in the valley, and that's where we know where we are now, and we'll be until the Lord comes. We also see the fact that Satan is defeated, chapters 10 and 11. Again, going back to his purpose statement in chapter 4. We see the poor and the outcasts have the gospel preached to them. This going back to Mary's song in chapter 1, and we see it picked up again in John's ministry in chapter 7, verse 22, when Jesus says, "This is the sign of the fact that I am the expected one." We see that salvation has come to God's people. This is in the songs in chapter 1 and chapter 2, and it follows into the rest of Luke's gospel. And then we see the Spirit's presence. It was prophesied by John the Baptist, promised by Jesus, fulfilled at Pentecost. And the outpouring of the Holy Spirit was an indication of the present reality of the kingdom of God. God reigns in our hearts, and His Spirit abides there in us. So all of these, for Luke, is a reflection of the fact that the kingdom is present with us here and now. So there is this inauguration of the kingdom of God looking for final consummation. So let's look at chapter 11 together. And again, we're primarily going to focus on the prayer. I have some contemplations. I'm hung up on the name, the name, and this designation, Father. So I'm just going to get into that this morning and just tell you we're going to get through the prayer. But when we get to chapter 11, we see the kingdoms in conflict. So it's very appropriate. We move from chapter 10, the 70 sent out, the progression of the mission. We see Jesus saying, "This is my statement in chapter 4. This is what I'm about." He sends out the 12 in chapter 9. He sends out the 70 and 72 chapter 10. We see this kingdom mission continues to carry on. It rolls right into the church. We're a part of it. We are a part of the kingdom mission. And we then need to pray like we're a part of it. So when we get into chapter 11, the heart of it is chapter 11, verses 14 through 28. And here we're talking about not a kingdom divided against itself, but we have kingdoms in conflict. And Jesus brings this out. Now, I'm just going to tell you, notice what happens in verses 14 and 15. So as he was casting out a demon and it was mute, when the demon had gone out, the mute man spoke and the crowds were amazed. Constant refrain through Luke's gospel, the amazement of the people, what Jesus was doing. But some of them said, "He casts out demons by Beelzebul, the ruler of the demons." Others, they test him and were demanding a sign from him from heaven. Now, it's interesting because Jesus responds to those in verses 14 and 15. The accusation he's casting out demons by Beelzebul. Verse 17 is his answer to that. Any kingdom divided against itself laid waste, right? House will divide against itself, falls. And he goes on to talk about the fact that I am not working under the direction of Beelzebul. He responds to verse 16 and those people when he gets to the sign of Jonah in verse 29. He says, "Then this generation is a wicked generation. It seeks a sign, right? And yet no sign will be given to it but the sign of Jonah." So he doesn't even respond to the second statement, the calling sign, till verse 29. So we see how these things are woven together in here. But the heart of it is the kingdoms in conflict. These are two kingdoms at odds with each other. And then when you look at chapter 11, you see that there is this interaction that Jesus has with two different groups of people, with his disciples in chapter 11, verses 1 through 13, and then with his opponents, chapter 11, verses 37 through 54, as he removes to the religious leaders, but it also includes the crowd, the multitudes, in verse 29. Now, why it's significant, at the end of chapter 11, he goes through the series of woes about the Pharisees. This is an interesting point. Okay, now Robert, Brandon, and I were talking before everyone got here when discussing the issue of Mormons and Brandon's interaction with some this last week. Here's what's intriguing. Here you have a religious group and they are included in a part of the kingdom of Satan. In other words, there is that reminder of the fact that there is the kingdom of God and there's the kingdom of Satan. That's it. That's it. So there is the book, and I have it on my shelf, and I believe the title was The Kingdom of the Cults, right? Ravi Zacharyson went updated a little bit and added some things to it, but so there's a second edition come out. The Kingdom, singular, of the Cults. So every other religion that is out there is a part of the kingdom of Satan. If they're not a Christian and in the kingdom of God, then they are a part of the kingdom of Satan. I just show you that when we look at Scripture, we're constantly reminded of the polarity of things. The wise, right, the foolish, the righteous, the wicked, those who are perishing, those who are being saved. This gives us the big picture looking at humanity, and sometimes we get lost in all the particulars and the fragments and sort of the shadowings of everything. It's significant that he includes the Pharisees in this as he deals with them as opponents. They are part of the kingdom of Satan. And this is a great thing for us to understand this reality. So there are just these two kingdoms. You're either a part of one or you're a part of the other. And he alternates between these two groups, the disciples and then the opponents. And he ends with the opponents of the Pharisees at the end of this chapter. At the heart of this section is 11:14 through 28, but it's interesting because he's going to connect it with chapter 11, verses 33 through 36 as he deals with light and darkness. How are you going to respond to Jesus Christ and this message of the kingdom of God? And that really is what we're saying about the light and the lamp, the parable. So turn with me to chapter 11, verse 33 through 36. This is a call to respond. This is a challenge. How are you going to respond to the light that is before you? He tells him already in verse 29, I'm not going to give you another sign. I've given you plenty. He makes the statement in verse 33, the lamp is lit. It's out. It's not hidden under a basket. It's not stashed away somewhere. It's before you. I'm not giving you any other signs. It's clear. Now the question is, how are you going to respond to this? And that really is the challenge. We go out there into the world and we are fighting a warfare, and it is a warfare. That is really what we're calling people to do, is respond to the light, to respond to that light. So before he transitioned into confronting the externalism of the Pharisees, his opponents, Luke is going to present Jesus' admonition to hear and to respond to his teaching instead of continuing in the darkness of ignorance. So he is going to challenge them to heed Jesus and his message of the kingdom. And this is like the lamp that is lit and illumines those who enter a house. It's set before them. How are you going to respond to this? There is nothing hidden about this. Therefore, there's no need for any other sign. There is no lack of illumination. It really has to do with the recipient. So here is the parable, and I just give you the sketch of it. You go back and meditate on light of this context. The purpose of the lamp is to guide with light, verse 33. So the light is that which shines from Jesus, and the people are not willing to receive it. The eye, Jesus goes on in verse 34, the eye is that means by which we receive and take it in into the inward mind. And if the eye is healthy, it lets in the light. But if it's unhealthy, right, the person is going to be filled with darkness. So then the challenge comes in verse 35, take care that the light is within you, not that. So the challenge is, be sure that the light that is in you is not darkness, that it is light. How do you respond? And really the challenge is this: there is no neutrality with Jesus Christ. There is none. This is why sometimes, and this is important for us, when we share the gospel, we have to remember, there's no neutral zone. There's no neutral zone. We might find some elements of commonality, the fact that we are created in the image of God and image bearers and that, but there is no neutral zone. The cross makes this so abundantly clear. In other words, I can't find this neutral area where we just sort of sit there and we start with zero and we argue towards God. You can't do that. It's impossible. It's impossible. There's no neutrality. You just have to decide. Either you accept him or you reject him. This is the thing with God. I can't even get into it. Exodus, though, the most amazing statement, chapter 3. The fact that God is. You have to come to grips with that. I mean, that's just the truth that is laid out there, and then you have to wrestle with that truth. Either you accept him or reject him. But he is. He is. He is just as real as anything else that we look at and know it's an existence. He is. And we can't argue to his existence by the sense of like he's some great idea, an amazing idea, and we're trying to get people to embrace that. No, he just is. Either you accept that or you reject that. So Jesus is laying this out for those in his audience. The light then inside equals that which shines outside, verse 36. So if you embrace the light and it illumines your life and it fills your life, then it's going to overflow into the lives of others. And really the paragraph then is a challenge against spiritual blindness and hardness of heart. How are you going to receive me and the message of the kingdom of God. So really, that is what it is. There is the kingdoms in conflict, and when we go out and witness, we realize there is warfare going on, and we are calling people to decide, to either accept or reject. But the reality is, Christ is who he is, yes, and he is ushered in the kingdom. So that's a nutshell. Go with me to the prayer, because this is where I wanted to hang. Those are the kingdom of God. Several things that he lays out here, characteristics about those who belong to the kingdom of God, chapter 11, verses 1 through 13. The section begins with the disciples' relationship to God in prayer and the cultivating of that internal relationship as opposed to the Pharisees that was all externalism. So it begins with a request from the disciples, chapter 11, verse 1. They come to Jesus after he'd finished praying and they say, "Will you teach us to pray as John taught his disciples?" It's followed then by a pattern in prayer, chapter 11, verses 2 through 4. And then Jesus is going to move into parabolic teaching about God's readiness to hear and then the certainty of God's answer to prayer in chapter 11, verses 9 and following. And then God will answer our prayer even more readily than any human father as he goes on to instruct us in chapter 11, verses 11 through 13. So really, 11, 1 through 13 is all about prayer. It's about prayer. That is the dynamic of the kingdom life. And those who belong to the kingdom and who realize that we are in spiritual warfare, we will pray. If we understand Ephesians 6, no one has to command us to pray. We'll pray. We'll be praying all the time. If we understand, we are at war. We are at war. And this is the problem that we have. We know when we go to the doctor, if there is a proper diagnosis, right, then there's going to be a proper remedy. But if there's an incorrect diagnosis, then the remedy is not going to fit the problem, correct? This is the same as anything else. This is a problem we have with our past president. You cannot say we're at war with terror, therefore we don't attack it the way that we ought to attack it and address it. If we don't understand that we are in conflict, then we are not going to approach it the way that we ought to. If we understand that we are in war against the kingdom of Satan and still are and will be until Christ returns, we will pray. We will pray. We will realize that that is the greatest weapon we have, is to get down on our knees. So that is the instruction that comes, but let me just tell you, it's not just about the prayer. The prayer is instructive. It really sums up all of Jesus' teaching. It is the longing for the consummation of the kingdom of God. It is eschatological. In other words, we're going to pray our theology. He says, when we address God, call him Father. There's tons of truth in that. We can't even get into all of it this morning, but there's tons of truth in that. The dependence upon God as Father, verse 3. When we come to him, we realize he is creator, we are creature, we are dependent beings, always will be. We understand the age of reconciliation with him, chapter 11, verse 4, the first part. It deals with the issue of forgiveness. The need for his power to persevere in this continued fight against Satan. These are all great theological truths. We can't even unpack all of them this morning. But this is, we will pray our theology. We will pray the things that we understand of God. And so Jesus is going to instruct us in all of these various areas. But let's walk through in the characteristics of those who belong to the kingdom of God. First, those of the kingdom of God realize the importance of prayer. Chapter 11, verse 1. So Jesus is off praying. And this is interesting because this is something he regularly did. And we find him in Luke's gospel at key points in prayer. I'll give you a couple examples. So he's going to choose, out of all of his disciples, he's going to choose 12. What does he do the night before? He spends the whole night in prayer. The whole night in prayer. When was the last time you did that when you had a major decision in your life? Right? When was the last time I did that when I had a major decision? When was the last time we spent all night in prayer before we made a major decision? And remember, part of that decision was he chose Judas, right? We spent all night in prayer. Mount of Transfiguration, what was he doing when he was there? He was in prayer. Key moments in Christ's life, he was in prayer. And all those other moments in between, we find him at time in prayer. Prayer was vital in his life. If we understand that we are in spiritual warfare, that it is the kingdom of God versus the kingdom of Satan, we will understand the importance of prayer. We understand life is war. It's a lot of other things, but it is always war. It is always war. Paul tells Timothy in chapter, and 1 Timothy, he tells him early on in chapter 1, and then he tells him again, to fight the good fight, war the good warfare. At the end of Paul's life in 2 Timothy chapter 4, he says, I have fought the good fight. Jude, contend for the faith. What? Fight for the faith, standing upon the faith. We're in war. And war does something to you when you understand that you're in battle. Now, I'm just going to tell you this, and I'm going to use the analogy and example to instruct us a little bit on prayer. Sometimes we have this false view of what prayer is. Prayer is not domestic intercom where we call upstairs for comforts down in the den. But sometimes this is how we see prayer, isn't it? God, take me out of the situation because it's so rough. No, he doesn't do that. He doesn't normally do. He usually leaves us there. And he's the one who brought the suffering on, right? To challenge us, to refine us. He didn't bring the fire to consume us, right? He brought it to remove the dross from our life. But prayer isn't for us to call upstairs to God and go, hey, my life's a little uncomfortable. Can we smooth it out? A couple extra pillows, a nice comforter. Can we get the heater on, right? That's not what prayer is. So if I can use the analogy of warfare, prayer is more like this. It's like our radio at the HQ. It's where we speak with God, the commander in chief, and we get our directions from him, but also we go to him for the needs that we need in the midst of this battle and conflict. I mean, it's such an amazing moment with Christ and his disciples because they see him in connection with heaven. And he gets done, they say, will you teach us to pray? Do you realize that when we pray, we are in connection with heaven? This is the most amazing thing that we have as believers, but it's amazing how seldom we pray, isn't it? I mean, if you really sit and think about your life, surely we pray over meals, and I won't even tell you the percentage of pastors who don't even do that. But what about like just in the regular daily aspect of life? How often do we stop and just talk with God and get connection with heaven? I mean, he sees the big picture. He knows what the big picture is. And oftentimes in battle, when you're down in the skirmishes, you just see the battalion that you're part of, the squad you're a part of. You see the personal battle you're in most of the time. We get so narrow visioned in what's going on around us. He knows the big picture. We need to stay in connection with the one who's in headquarters, who sees the whole thing, right? And can direct us and guide us. And so here we see Jesus in prayer and his disciples respond to that and they ask for instruction. Now, I give you this thought because I normally do this, but this is from C.S. Lewis. And I just say the importance of understanding we're in war and conflict. It is vital. And I know this is not a biblical book in one sense, but I just, interesting dialogue. So Screwtape, have you read Screwtape Letters? I think it's a great book. So Screwtape is the devil and Wormwood is the subordinate evil spirit. So here's the interaction. So Screwtape tells Wormwood, the devil tells the evil spirit, not to hope for too much from war. And this is referring to World War II and the agonies of the war and so on like that, right? But he explains that war will not destroy the faith of real believers and will produce an unwanted seriousness about life, death, and the issues of eternity. War has a way of doing that. When you realize you're in war, you realize the brevity of life. And what it does is it narrows you. It helps you to remove unnecessary things in your life, doesn't it? When you realize this could be the end, right? You just start going through life and go, you know what? I don't need this. I don't need that. I don't need this. I don't need that, right? These are the things that really matter. It also helps you to appreciate those little blessings that God gives you, right? When you realize you're in conflict and then he gives you those moments that you just like, man, he enables you to rejoice. So the dialogue goes on. And he goes on to say, how disastrous for us, the devil explains, is the continual remembrance of death which war enforces. We keep trying to avoid that fact. He says, one of our best weapons, contented worldliness, is rendered useless. In wartime, not even a human can believe that he is going to live forever. We need to keep in mind that we are in war. And it must shape our mindset for our life that is set before us and the things that we do. It is vital for the disciples as the mission begins to expand that Jesus is going to instruct them in these things and keep them before them that you are in conflict with Satan and you will be until I return. Another mark, those of the kingdom of God, they commune with him in a filial relationship. Chapter 11, verse 2. Notice, he said to them, when you pray, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Now, I love this because it reflects relationship. And in chapter 10, verse 22, Jesus says this, all things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows who the Son is except for the Father, and who the Father is except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son will reveal him. This is a unique experience of the New Testament. I'll just tell you, if you read through the Old Testament, very seldom do we find Father referred to in reference to God. The majority of the time is the New Testament, so much so that early theologians used to refer to the fact that this is a designation that is introduced, a new designation of God introduced in the New Testament. That's how infrequent it is in the Old Testament, how frequent it is in the New Testament. Now just dwell upon the very fact of this. 273 times it is found in the Gospels. The only time that it is found used in reference to anyone other than the disciples is in Matthew 23:9. In other words, we can suggest, and well so, that this is a term, a designation that is only between Jesus and his followers. He introduces to them that God is Father. This is something unique. This is something amazing. I mean, we can go to God and call upon him as Father and know that he will hear us. Now, I'm going to do something, but I have to wait for a sec. So Jesus has a relationship with us as Son. He is bringing us then into this true relationship with him as Father. And it is an intimate relationship. And so therefore, he has us to reflect in this relationship when we pray. And it reflects intimacy without a doubt. And it's interesting because this invocation, it doesn't have any qualifiers by it. It's just simply you call him Father. There's nothing else attached to that. It's just Father. Okay? But let me just add this thought to you. It also reflects authority. It also reflects authority. I was just thinking about this. All right, let me try and condense this down. El Shaddai, God Almighty in the Old Testament, Exodus 6. He tells Moses, this is how I revealed myself to Abraham. He's going to show El Shaddai. El Shaddai reflects in the power of God, his ability to subject the powers of nature and make them subservient to his works of grace. Okay? Give you some examples. So the plagues that come upon the nation of Israel, just think about it. So God reveals to Moses, this is who I am, El Shaddai. He tells him this designation. He gives him this name. But then he's going to experience something about this. And these are amazing things. So in the plagues, we have the one with light. And there are things scientists don't even understand about light. But just think about this for a moment. So God says, I'm going to put darkness over all of Egypt, okay, over all of Egypt, 3 days. It's going to be such darkness that the text says that they're going to feel the darkness. Now, I've been in places that have been so dark, I can't even see the hand before my face. So dark that you feel it closing in on you. You feel the burden of that darkness. He says they're going to sit in that for 3 days and not one person is going to see another and they will not leave their place. Think about this. But he says, but in the land of Goshen where the nation of Israel is, my light's going to shine for those 3 days. That's awesome. I don't know about you, but things like that, it's just like when God reveals himself, that's El Shaddai. So when God reveals things like that about himself, you're just like awestruck, right? I mean, things like, I want to fly out of my seat and just like, yes, that's my God. Don't you ever feel like screaming like that when you read the Bible sometimes? You see things about God, right? Or how about, so when they're in the wilderness, okay, you got almost 2 million people and he makes water come out of a rock. That's El Shaddai, right? This is my name. A rock. Seriously, a rock. Water comes out. No underground fountain that pours through and seeps through. No, out of a rock. Okay? That's God. Joshua, when he's taken over the land, right? In chapter 10 of Joshua. So the Amorites, they gather together. They join forces. They come against Joshua. What happens to the sun? It does what? Stand still. So that's El Shaddai, right? God can make those things subservient to him. The sun can stand still. I believe that. I don't know about you, but I believe that happened. Okay, so here's the thing. Here's the thing. That's not even a glimmer of who God is. Just think about this for a moment. That name, the name Father, those incidences, it's like when Moses asked to see the glory of God. God says, no, you can't handle the full of me. So I'm going to hide you in the cleft. I'm going to cover you. I'm going to pass by. And after I pass by you, you're going to see a little trace of my back trail. That's all you can see. Otherwise, you'll drop dead. That's those moments. That's El Shaddai. That's Father. That's every designation that God gives us about himself. It is just merely a glimmer of who he is. In other words, God has many names, but he has no name. There's not one name that captures all that he is. Not even Theos, not even Kurios, Lord, not even Pater, Father, not even El Shaddai, not even Yahweh. So when we come to this name, when we look upon Father and call him Father, there is relationship, there is intimacy, but there is authority. It maintains the authoritative rule. It expresses intimate affection without the cheap familiarity. See, there are things when God reveals them, like the sun standing still and that, I want to just fly out of my seat and scream, go, this is my God. But then all of a sudden, God at times in our life, he helps us to see that's not even a fragment of who I am. To me, as God, from his perspective, that's ordinary. You don't even see the depths of my being. Those moments, my soul aches. Tears well up in my eyes. I can't breathe. I don't know if that happens to you. That happened to me last night. I lay in bed. I can't breathe. Because I can call this God who is so amazingly awesome, I can't even comprehend the infinitude of who he is, the depths of his being, but I can call him Father and I can bring my request to him and say, I need, and put it at his feet and know that he will hear me and he wants to answer those prayers. We don't need to go any further in this prayer, but there. But please do not cheapen when we come to God in prayer. Do not cheapen. We understand prayer is worship. There has to be reverence and respect. And this designation does not nullify either one of those things. When we call him Father, do not impose any kind of temporal thing upon that. Understand it as who he is. This is God condescendingly approaching us, allowing us to get a glimmer of his revelation, but yet still not even knowing the fullness of the depth of his being. God is holy, and he is to be approached with that in recognition. He is the great one. He is the unassailable one. He is the incomprehensible one, and yet we can call him Father. It's the most amazing truth. In this conflict, we know that we are going to struggle. There are going to be trials and temptations, and we know that we can call upon him Father without any other qualification, just Father. Those of the kingdom of God, they desire God's glory to be revealed and his will to be fulfilled. This is in the statements, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. It's all about God. It just is. Notice the first part of this prayer, your, then he gets to us. But even in the us part, when we bring our request to him, he who provides is the one who receives glory for the provision. It's all about God. Ministry, it's about God, not man. Mission, the mission is about God, not man. We have to remember this when it comes to our own life in the church. How many times do we come to church thinking it's about us? It's not about us. It's not about us. I can't remember the artist, the singer. She sang that song. I can't remember her name. She sang that song that you're so vain. I bet you think the song is about you. That's us. Do you hear me? That's us. We are so vain. We think it's all about us. It's not about us. It's about the glory of God. It's about the glory of God. We're the peripheral. He is it. You know, the chief end of God is what? To glorify himself. Not to exalt man. And this is what Jesus brings out for us when you approach him as Father. This is what brings the reverence and the awe. Hallowed be your name. We seek his glory. Now, it's interesting because this verb is in the passive form. In other words, he's saying this, prayer in response to God. Pray to God that he might act in a way that he would lead men to the hallowing of his name, that he would lead them to the glorification of himself. So God is petitioned to bring about a situation in which men will reverence and worship him instead of blaspheming him and sinning against him. This is missionary prayer. This should be our prayer. This should be the prayer of our life. The first thing that we seek is God's glory. Think about our prayer life. What is the first thing that we pray about? Usually it's what we need. Usually we come to God in prayer. We're asking for stuff. Jesus says, when you pray, set him first. It's all about him. All through Jesus' life, when he prayed, it was about fulfilling the will of the Father and everything. And you realize that missions exist because there is no honoring and worshiping of God? That's why we're here. It's what we're doing, is we're leading people to glorify God, to worship him, to revere him. It is the aim to engage then in the passion of God for his name among those who reject and revile the name of God. This is what he is praying towards. And as we pray, thus we will then behave. It's interesting if you read the Apostle Paul and his different prayers, notice how many times the things that he prays for and then how he acts upon those prayers. It's almost as though he knows that God is going to help answer, but he didn't sit there and wait for it. He gets out there and starts to work on the issue of what he is praying for. But I just ask this question, when in our own life, when we are praying, we think about our life, do we hallow the name of God above every other claim in our life to allegiance and affection? Are we concerned with the glory of God? Because that's really what all life is about. That's what mission's about. That's why we're leading people to Christ for. It's about God's glory. And so Jesus starts off with this aspect of the prayer. So what a believer is supposed to hope for, long for, pray for is the full realization and culmination of God's promised rule. So part of hallowing his name is that his kingdom would come, that there would be a culmination of everything. In other words, ultimately there would be an eradication of evil and a manifestation of his righteousness. All of this should be in anticipation of our prayer. In other words, we should be driven by the eschaton, by the end times, but we understand that there is missional implications by this prayer. If we're honest, right, if we're honest about our prayers are so temporal. They're so us, and usually it's not even us or we, it's I, me, or my. And usually it's about temporal things. And usually it's about physical things. It's interesting, if you look at Paul's prayer life, very seldom do we see any reflection of physical prayers. We see that in the thorn of the flesh, if that's a physical thing there, yeah? The only time I can think of. Those of the kingdom of God will walk in dependence, chapter 11, verse 3. Give us this day our daily bread. This is just walking dependence on God, and we have the exhortation that comes in chapter 12. He says in verse 31 of chapter 12, but seek his kingdom, and these things will be added unto you. Do not be afraid, little flock, for your Father has chosen gladly to give you the kingdom. Therefore, verse 33, sell your possessions and give to charity. Make yourselves money belts, which will not wear out, an unfading treasure in heaven, where no thief comes, nor moth destroys. For your treasure is there, your heart will be also. We can lay our needs before God and know that he will answer and he will respond. And he willingly and desires to do that. Those of the kingdom of God recognize the need for forgiveness. Chapter 11, verse 4. Just some thoughts in this. Forgive us our sins. And he goes on to say, for we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us. Here's some thoughts I had in regards to this. You can write them down. Just ponder on them. One who is not forgiving does not realize the need for forgiveness. If I can look at this statement in a different way. The statement in verse 4 also recognizes this fact. One who is willing to forgive is aware of who the sin is really against. In other words, their statement in verse 4 reflects the fact that when others sin against them, they don't demand their own rights, and really they see their own failures in reality and they're willing to forgive. The other, and I think is important, is this. One who is willing to forgive realizes that one's relationship with others impacts one's relationship with God. We realize that if our relationship this way, right, is well, then down here, right, it'll work these things out down this way. But sometimes we forget that the reverse is also true, that our relationship with those down here can impact that one up there. Example, in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7, you husbands in the same way, live with your wives in an understanding way, as with someone weaker, since she is a woman, and show her honor as a fellow heir of the grace of life, so that your prayers will not what? Will not be hindered. There is an impact that our relationship to other people has to our relationship to God. And sometimes we go, why isn't God answering this prayer? Maybe we ought to evaluate the relationships here, right? And the life this way, and see if it's impacting the other. Those of the kingdom of God come to recognize that God is ready towards doing goodness. Chapter 11, verses 5 and following, I leave these parables for you, but really, if I can sum them all up, is simply that God is ready to do good. He just is. And Jesus uses the example of earthly fathers. If they're willing to do such good things for their children, when they ask, how much more is your heavenly Father willing to do good in your life? In other words, he's receptive. So the exhortation comes in verse 9, but I say to you, right, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened. So invitations towards prayer. I'm not even going to get into this. I'll give you the outline if you want to write it down. Those are the kingdom of Satan, 11, 14 through 54. Simply the characteristics, those of the kingdom of Satan object to Jesus' authority. Those of the kingdom of Satan opt for neutrality towards Jesus, and that's not possible. And I don't know, I can't even get into all this. And those of the kingdom of Satan emphasize externality instead of inward spirituality. I pray that you will go back over chapter 11. There is so much here, but I pray that you will take the time to reflect on the aspect of prayer, that internal cultivation of relationship with God as Father. But realize what is being revealed here in the context of which is being revealed. We are at war. We are at conflict. We will be. Prayer is a vital part of our relationship in the midst of this conflict. It's amazing how seldom, though, believers pray. That's why we need to keep this before our mind's eye, the nature of the times in which we are in, because they will help shape our minds in regards to life and our relationship to God. May God help us as we seek to contend with Satan and his kingdom, and we do it under the power of God. Dad, would you close in a word of prayer, please?